Hello and welcome to Is This Good? The show where we boldly, conclusively, and scientifically decide what things in this big wide world are good. I'm Matt Austin, and with me are two amazing panelists from No Dunks, Trey Kirby and Jason Doyle. We're having a threesome. Welcome to Is This Good?
Thanks for having us, Matt.
I got a feeling this is going to be a good one.
I feel it's going to come in hot. If you have topics for a future show, send them to me at StartersMatt on Twitter or email us at isthisgoodpod@gmail.com. Last week I asked you for more settle this questions. These are bigger type questions where you're having an argument with someone or you need a debate settled, and you delivered. You sent in some great ones. We've got a great one coming up at the end of the show, but if you have more, continue to send them in. If you're watching live on YouTube, be good and vote in the polls. Help us take the pulse of the people. The premise of the show is very simple. I'm going to give you a topic, and you're going to tell me if it's good. You guys ready to go on the first topic?
Oh, yeah.
Okay, here we go. Writing Yelp reviews. Is this good? Not reading Yelp reviews. We can get to that later. Writing Yelp reviews. And let me start off the top by asking if either of you have ever written a Yelp review.
Great question. I've definitely done a Google review by request, you know, I have said, like, a plumber come to the house and they ask specifically, hey, could you write me a Google review? And I've done that. But only positive.
I have. Well, yeah, I mean, I've done the same too. I had a customer service person, I had to return a pan, there was a scratch on it, it was a lifetime warranty. And I decided to see if that was true. And this woman was very helpful. And she also asked me to leave a Google review.
Oh, great. And it was positive.
Of course. Wouldn't have left it if it was negative.
Oh, you wouldn't leave a negative review?
Well, not in that case where someone asked me. Same thing with my guitar teacher. Also asked me to leave a Google review. And since I'm still taking lessons, I wasn't about to be like, he's a little sloppy on the neck.
Poor finger strength.
So Trey, I assume you have not written one?
My guess is that I probably do have a deep in the archives Yelp review somewhere way back when. I mean, Yelp has been around for such a long time that I probably wrote Yelp reviews that I don't even remember from, like, back in the Lombard days, would be my guess.
Wow.
You're saying we're not talking about reading Yelp reviews, but we got to talk about reading Yelp reviews, because that's why I think writing Yelp reviews are good. I personally am not writing them these days. Maybe I would if asked by somebody. It just seems like a nice thing to do. But if I'm going to go to a restaurant, I'm 100% going to be reading the reviews, so somebody's got to write them, which is why I think they're good. I actually think reviews are better than ratings when it comes to Yelp. Because in Yelp, it's like, we'll give you a one-star rating just because we didn't like one single service person, you know? Like, that's too much of a docking to do there. I think there's too much of a range from one star to five stars that I would rather get a little granular with the reviews.
Okay, but then that's a good question, because to read the Yelp reviews, you have to trust the people that are writing them. Do you trust the people writing reviews?
No, that's the other part. I don't trust the people writing the reviews, but I do trust Yelp for some reason. And all I'm really interested in is, like, the helpful reviews or the tips, you know, when somebody will specifically mention a dish or an appetizer that they may have gotten at some restaurant. I don't know. I feel like I don't trust the people individually who are doing it, but I trust the whole of people to come to the right conclusion.
Yeah.
I mean, I actually agree with you. I think it can be that, what's that phrase? You shouldn't take criticism from someone that you wouldn't ask advice from. So a lot of the times you are reading them and you're right, it is one star, and it's because they made them wait 10 minutes past when their reservation was or something like that. And you're like, well,
sure.
Okay. That's not really relevant to me. But I do agree, someone's got to be writing them. Have you ever been dissuaded from something by a Yelp review? Or do you have, like, a limit of, if it's below X number of stars, I will not go to this restaurant?
Yeah, it's tough. I mean, I've definitely been to some one star, or I've gone to places, or I've looked up a place that I like, and it's got, like, one star on it. I'm like, what? I love that place.
I disagree.
Yeah, exactly. And it's usually, you know, it's a greasy spoon or a shitty Chinese restaurant or something like that. Like, but I love it. And so, you know, people's expectations Roger Ebert always would review a movie based on its genre, and if it was meant to be a stupid movie, then he would rate it as such. And I would appreciate that, the same sort of treatment for Yelp writers out there. But yeah, I mean,
I definitely have let Yelp reviews influence my orders at a restaurant. You know, if I'm I think we had this on Is This Good previously, scouting the menu when you're going to go out to a restaurant. I'll scout a menu, and then I'll go to the scouting report and read about the various, you know, say I'm considering three dishes at a restaurant. One of them sounds like a banger in the reviews. The other two sound okay. I'm going with the banger. We'll see if those people are lying to us.
Yeah, I do find that restaurant reviews, I don't want to go so far as to say they're accurate, but they're helpful, generally speaking. Sometimes they're not. But the things that I find, once you get away from restaurants, Yelp is the Wild West. I mean, I don't use Yelp too much for non-restaurant. But for instance, I need to find a place to wash my car. And I find that there's three businesses that never get positive Yelp reviews. The post office. Find me a post office with more than the 3-star review.
Oh, they shipped them out.
Yeah,
five stars.
Wait, shouldn't it be? I mean,
yeah. Oh, you took my package and it's gone? 5 stars. Pretty simple review.
Oh, I would say 4 stars. Did it get there? Now we're at 5.
Okay. Right. Yeah.
Banks, always negative Yelp reviews.
Oh, I've never dove into a bank review before.
That's crazy.
I know, because it's figuring like what could be so bad here. But I mean, also, like, how much time are you spending in a bank anymore?
Yeah.
You know, I mean, it's not the 90s anymore.
It's not the 90s. You can deposit checks on your phone.
Exactly. And then the third thing is car washes. People are so goddamn sensitive about their cars. So JD, can you throw up this? I was looking for a place to wash my car. Couldn't find a place above 3 stars. And I did some redactions here. But let me just read the first line of this review. It's a 1-star review for a car wash that's near my house. It says, their weekly special is only special at taking people's money. I shouted there if you're listening, because that's in all caps. And then this person went through a 5-point review of everything that was wrong. I just redacted that because there was some personal information in there. But then I like this last line here. You're better off washing your car with a toothbrush and a puddle of piss. And then in all caps, he says, I don't want to go back to have them clean it again because I shouldn't have to.
Whoa, what?
This is the worst car wash in LA County.
I mean, honestly, if you go to a car wash and they wash your car so good that you never have to go back and get it washed again, that's an easy 5 stars.
Yeah, for sure.
Yes, I think in this case, this guy was referring to, they were saying, well, fine, if you don't like it, then come back. But this place also had a hilarious review where a guy took a picture of a t-shirt, a white t-shirt that was stained. And he said, it was a 1-star review, and he said, this place was so bad that this is what my t-shirt looked like after I got back in the car. He was saying that this seat was so dirty that it left stains on his white t-shirt.
Wow. That's pretty
okay,
bad.
That's pretty, I like that level of detail, actually.
Yeah. Pun intended.
Yeah,
so I would say don't believe any reviews for a car wash, because guess what? I took my place this car wash and it was fine. Yeah. The car was cleaner than when I brought it in, and that's all you're asking
for.
So
no toothbrush, no puddle of piss. All good.
No puddle of piss. I mean, if you had piss going through a those like high pressure hoses,
yeah,
don't tell me that wouldn't clean your car.
I agree.
Oh, urine sterile, right?
Don't start. When it comes to washing your car, it's fine.
It's actually really good for it. I agree with what Dreamshake says here in the stream team. You need to wash your own car if your expectations are that high.
Yeah.
100%.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, I'm never doing that. I mean, not least of which because I live in an apartment where I don't have access to a hose. But for like $15.99 plus a $5 tip, how much better can I do?
Right. The no better.
No better.
Yeah.
Exactly. One other thing I want to point out, though, is that you could see a lot of businesses, especially during COVID, on both sides. The type of business that was very pro-mask. Sometimes they get inundated with 1-star reviews saying these places are infringing on my freedoms. But then on the other side, places that didn't have big masking policies, like in the earlier stages of COVID, 1-star reviews, especially in LA, of people being like, I felt, you know, scared here, nervous here. They weren't enforcing this policy. And I was, again, looking for a place to do yoga. And before you put it up, JD, I just want to explain quickly. So this woman had written a scathing review about how they did not have a masking policy that she was comfortable with. And from other reviews I read, I think it was actually a legit complaint. Because they had put up a sign that said something like, we don't want to infringe on your privacy, so we're not going to ask or tell you to do anything. Which, I mean, is a nice way of saying, we're not going to enforce any kind of masking or health policy here. Then the owner of the business wrote a scathing review in return, calling her out, being like, you suck, you're an annoying person, we don't want you here anymore. Okay, so you'd think that the matter is settled. You know how sometimes, because a place like a yoga place would have your birthday, they'll send out an automated message on your birthday. Thanks for being a member here at, you know, Sweaty Yoga, whatever.
That's where you remember it.
We just want to say thanks to you. So she then, months later, wrote another Yelp review responding to this. And JD put up this this image here. So it says, happy anniversary from, I've blacked out the place. And in the place where it would just auto-fill your name, Dear Matthew or whatever, it says, Dear Marion Yelp Troll. So clearly what they had done is, after she wrote the first review, they put her name in the system as Marion Yelp Troll.
Yeah.
And then months later, when it was her birthday, they set this up. So then she wrote again, calling this place out. And this place does seem like it's staffed by dicks, but this is very funny.
That's hilarious. I love that. I want to be known. I want an accidental reveal of what businesses call me in their database, you know?
Yeah.
Like, I mean, it might be nice. It might be friendly beard guy, or it might be like a smelly dude or whatever. Like, I don't know.
Yeah, what did you get labeled as in the in the database? I mean, Brad is asking in the stream team here, which kind of is in the same vein, should restaurants be able to leave reviews on customers? Like the other side of Yelp, reverse
100%.
Yelp.
I think
I
so.
I mean, it's more and more common, I think, that people are counteracting negative reviews by saying, like, actually, here's what happened. You walked in, you had a table for eight, you were 15 minutes late, you were one person out of a table for eight, you demanded to be seated. You proceeded to yell at the waiter and to comment on the temperature of the tap water and, like, whatever. Things like that. So what are the people saying, Trey? Are they saying writing Yelp reviews is good?
Oh, this one is tight right now, Matt. Ooh, right, so now, tight. 51% are saying not good. But it's been dropping slow, like, pretty steadily. It was 55% not good about 5 minutes ago. Huh. So I feel like your pitches right now are kind of... are kind of swaying the audience here, because we might be able to flip this thing by the time it's done, especially because I am pro Yelp reviews, because one of the funniest moments we've had as a group is you and Skeets reading a Yelp review for a restaurant in Portland. I pulled the clip earlier.
Here's a person who really took time to build a story. In the words of Alexander, I was having a terrible, horrible, no good, very bad day. It involved a genuinely sociopathic ex-boyfriend from Montana arriving in Portland, Oregon. I would move him right by me. There's a reason I moved away from Montana, and it's not just because Portland is so awesome. I don't think I need to explain much more, but then she will go on for another 6 months.
Oh my god, no! No, keep scrolling!
My fabulous friend decided that the only way to deal, as well as hide, was to go out on the town and render me properly schnockered. After a fantastic evening at Montage and some wonderful alcoholic selections there, we headed off to Hubris, as I had never been. I'm pretty happy.
She just got to the restaurant.
I'm pretty happy with their selection of Hubris over a tequila bar, especially as I was an emotional wreck and those two things just don't mix. Also, tequila makes my clothes fall off. Thank you, friends. When we ran to Hubris, I'm not gonna lie, the hallway, or maybe just the people standing in it, kind of smelled like cat piss. I think that this would be a sign of a bad experience to come, but you'd be wrong.
See?
Wow.
Yelp reviews are good, because it's fun to get together with your buddies and just read a hilarious Yelp review, but you're hearing that Yelp review, and it gives you almost no sort of feel of what Hubers is actually going to be like.
Right.
But it's fun to read. And like you're saying, businesses kind of like clapping back at customers is always a great read, I feel like, on Yelp. So Yelp beefs, Yelp reviews, very good. Yelp ratings, take them or leave them.
Thanks for that blast from the past. That was what? That must have been 2011, so yeah. 11 years ago.
Yeah.
In Portland. I remember, I mean, I didn't really remember that video, but I remember schnockered. I remember her saying schnockered.
Properly schnockered.
and that the hallway smelled like cat piss. All right, so basically we're seem to be in agreement. If you've ever read a Yelp review, you kind of have to say that writing them is good, even though we are all lurkers on the platform. All right, moving on to the next question. Daniel R. asks, throwing your dog's poop, throwing your dog's poop bag in someone else's trash, is this good? You guys both have dogs. I don't, but I have a very strong opinion on this, which is that shit is shit. Your garbage is shit. Shit is shit. Why do you care so much if someone puts shit on top of your shit when someone's coming along and cleaning that shit and putting that shit in a truck, dumping your garbage bag, your garbage can back on the street to be, again, refilled with your own shit? Why do people get so upset about this?
Well, for one thing, some people, especially if you're in Toronto or somewhere where there's rodents and things that can get into the garbage, they put their garbage bins either in their garage or in an indoor space, like some sort of indoor space, or at the very least at the side of their house, close to the house. So, and shit.
Okay, well,
shit
I agree
stinks.
With you, but that's trespassing. I'm not advocating trespassing.
I'm saying, like, if. Say the garbage truck has already come, it's empty, you're out there with your dog, you throw the shit in, and okay. And then you're wheeling it back. I mean, that's the scenario that I'm thinking of. And most of the neighbors around here, they bring their, at least bring them back up to the house. Whether they put them inside, I don't know, but I certainly don't. But I also, you know, our garbage bins are right outside this garage door, so I don't want shit in there, that's for sure.
Oh, so you're against this?
No, I'm not against it. But I mean, I do it. I do it all the time. Yeah. I do it all the time. But I have very specific parameters of and rules of when I can do it. For example, if it's not garbage day and there's a bin out there, I'm putting it in there. Right?
Okay.
And
whether it's full or not.
Whether it's full or not, because fuck them. Bring in your stuff. Bring in your bins, because they shouldn't be out on the street.
This is dog poop as vigilante justice.
That's right. That's right. Yeah, and that's basically it, I guess. And if it's garbage day and the garbage truck hasn't come yet, and then I'll throw it on, nice little cherry on top, right there.
But those like the Grinch tossing bags up to the that's to right. the sleigh.
That's right. But I do it very, very incognito or surreptitiously, because I'd never want to get caught doing it ever.
Right. Because well, have either of you ever been yelled at for doing this?
100% for me. You, Trey?
I don't think I've ever been yelled at, but I err on the side of not putting poop in other people's garbage cans. But honestly, Matt, I'm happy to hear your take on things, because I thought you'd be vehemently against somebody dropping a bag in your garbage can, because I feel like people, for the most part, don't want extra poop in their can. But I'm with you. I'm like, that thing is going to stink regardless. It's garbage. We're all throwing it out. Yeah. Who cares?
Right.
If you see my garbage can sitting out by the side of the road, feel free to throw a bag in there.
Now, would you consider putting your money where your mouth is and putting a sign on your garbage that says, "We welcome your poop"?
No. Yeah. I'm not like soliciting it, but if you want to leave it behind, as long as the bag is tied, it's all good.
Yeah, that's the only rule. If the bag is tied,
yeah,
put it inside. This came up
okay.
That
I would maybe put on my garbage can, actually. That's pretty
yeah,
cool.
That's actually pretty cool. Yeah.
I find it funny that people are always like, you know what? We don't have communities anymore. No one knows their neighbors anymore. It's like, you want to have a community. You don't want to have trash on the streets. Everyone's garbage should be, in a sense, a communal garbage. Now, if you're going to be putting, like, you know, old furniture or, I don't know, some large item or something, then fine, I understand. But there are not that many public garbages anymore.
No, you're right.
True.
So why wouldn't you want to increase the community feeling and just say, hey, if you're walking your dog, you could just throw your poop anywhere?
Yeah. We got a couple of neighbors who actually put out plastic bags you know. But it's almost, what's the word? It's like, just fucking pick up after your dog. You know what I mean? Like, yeah. It's more in your face, I find. Like, take a bag. And I don't like there's some lawns around here that have the, don't lay your dog shit on my lawn. It's just like.
With a little statue of a dog, yeah, taking a shit on the lawn.
Yeah, exactly.
Okay, exactly. Let's burn this question, because actually this is something that someone else has written in, is those passive aggressive lawn signs.
Mm.
Always bad.
Always bad. Never good.
I mean, I don't think they're good, but also, like, if you don't want a dog on your lawn, how else are you supposed to get that point across? You know? You can sit out there and yell at them, but that's even weirder.
Well, you can put up a gate, A.
You can put up a gate, fair enough.
Or you can stand out there vigilantly with a hose or something, or like a scarecrow type thing where just a sprinkler. That's, you know, that's out there.
Ironically, the sprinkler is filled with piss.
Could be.
Yeah. What's the general rules? As someone who's only walked dogs very infrequently, can your dog pee anywhere? I know poop, I know, is a different story, but can it pee anywhere?
I mean, it's very hard to... Well, you can control, I suppose, where the dog goes, I guess, but not really, especially a leg lifter. You know, it's just Cosmo just basically he'll suddenly just meh. There's nothing you can do.
Yeah.
Why do people care about this? Why do people with, you mean not the people that have the houses, why do they care if a dog pees on the edge of their lawn?
Well, I know there's a chemical in like a female dog's urine that can kill grass depending on the dog and the grass. So for me, if I see somebody sitting outside their house and I'm walking yams, I'm hustling on by that house to get to the next one to ruin their lawn. I don't want to ruin somebody's lawn in front of them. And I guess maybe the worry with a dump would be over-fertilization of the grass, and then you get, like, you know, like a random tall spot just growing up from there. That doesn't look great either.
No.
Well, I'm glad you said it's female dogs that have that, because I already have a sign on my lawn that says no bitches allowed. Not for dogs, but now
but it's good that
it's inclusive. Did you know that it's technically illegal in a lot of counties to put your poop or put anything in someone else's trash?
Really?
It's called illegal dumping. Here's a quote. I was reading an article about it. A person who disposes waste into a neighbor's trash can, assuming the neighbor pays to have the trash disposed of, is committing theft, and it is therefore illegal, said Criminal Investigations Division Interim Lieutenant Adam McCambridge.
Imagine making a citizen's arrest on that.
Oh, God.
Hey! Get back here! I don't know. People are protective over their garbage, I guess. Why? It's all going to the garbage.
Yeah, exactly. So I'm saying it's good. Trey and JD, I assume you're saying good.
100% good.
Okay,
yeah,
what are
definitely
the
good.
Saying?
And currently 57% of the stream team is saying it's good. They're dropping bags.
There we go.
We're all dropping bags, but we're all feeling bad about it because of the other 43%. The other 43% is way more vocal. And us bag droppers are just trying to sneak them in the best we can without anybody noticing.
We just don't want to walk around with a bag of shit in
our hands.
Just like you're out for like 3-4 kilometers with a bag. Like, it sucks.
But I'm with you. Like, if I do have a bag and I see a garbage can, I'm like looking up and down the street, making sure nobody's out so I can.
Yeah.
Pshw,
yeah.
Just
totally.
Like a quick lift and toss.
I've had Cosmo poop relatively early during the walk, and then I'll be like, I'm not carrying it. It's not garbage day. I don't see any cans, so I'll tie up the bag and I'll leave it sort of at the side of the road. I leave it in sort of the side, like on beside the sidewalk in the gutter of the road, basically, with the intention to pick it up. And I have, and a couple of times I've come back and I've. And it's been gone. Like
somebody
picked it up. Yeah. So then I'm like, somebody in my neighborhood saw me just pick up my dog shit and then leave it at the side of the road. So I felt embarrassed and ashamed But I was coming back, you know.
Yeah, you needed a passive aggressive sign.
Yeah, exactly.
I'm coming back. Don't worry.
Yeah,
this is my shit.
Don't touch my bag.
Don't touch my shit. All right, I think we are all agreeing. Support your community. Support your local dog owners, and just let people drop a well-wrapped shit in your bag.
And consider putting a sign on your garbage can to let others know that you're a bag-friendly garbage household.
Yeah. That's right. And if you've done that, send us a picture.
Please do that, actually.
And maybe we should make some lawn signs that's like, you know, in this house we believe.
That shit can be put into any vessel put out in the neighborhood.
Yeah, we'll get those. We'll get some merch going.
Yeah, let's do it.
All right, we got to go to break. When we come back, we're going to talk about what happens when you're very sweaty at the gym.
Guys, busy weekend in the ATL. Mm. And I was the most Atlanta dad to ever dad. It was Porch Fest here in a neighborhood close by, and my kids were playing in it. And none of those kids in that band have licenses. So I did what I swore I would never, ever do again. I hauled drums and amps up and down stairs, ran cables behind planters. I said sibilance into a mic multiple times. That's right, I was a GD roadie for Mongo Pretty. My kids' bands had to knock on the door once. Excuse me, ma'am, I think we blew one of your circuits on the front porch here. Embarrassing, but it was fine. It was a gorgeous day. The kids killed it, and I spent the rest of the afternoon drinking PBRs on strangers' lawns, and that went well into the evening. So the next day, had to get up early. Why? To go get those drums.
Oh.
Ugh, brutal. Thank goodness for my old friend. Starbucks. Oh my God, why am I so bad at this?
Does it look like a mirror or what's going on?
Yeah, I don't know. It's I'm not used to this. I'm not an on-air guy. Starbucks, buy a energy drink. And thank goodness I had the sense to hide my last can of mango guava behind cans of Guinness, which is a risk because look at how eye-catching this is.
I
mean, it's a beautiful label amongst the black cans, but the kids were fooled. They didn't see it because they sucked these things down like crazy. And I sucked this thing down. Fridge opened Sunday morning. Glug, 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 glug. And I was good to go, man. Got in that car. Got in the RAV4. I had so much energy. I could have taken those drums, assembled, and just threw them back into the back of the RAV4. I didn't, though. I sat in the driver's seat. I didn't even get out. It's like, kids, welcome to the glamorous rock and roll lifestyle. It's Sunday morning. Go get those drums. And, you know, listen, this one's my favorite, the mango. Oh, my God. Why can't I do this? Mango.
Yep.
But they also have raspberry lime, which is very elusive. Can't find it anywhere.
Yeah.
I don't know what's going on with it.
We've got JD in the stream team saying they sell out in stores all the time.
Yeah, they do. It's true. And then the pineapple passion fruit. Not my favorite, but, you know, this one's the best. Mango guava. So you can get them. You can get the two of them, not the raspberry one. It's available online at grocery stores, convenience stores, and gas stations nationwide.
Welcome back to Is This Good? Where we believe love is love. Poop is garbage. And garbage is shit. Therefore, all poop is shit. You know, that could use some work. I'm going to work on that one. All right. Dave asks, showering at the gym, is this good? And he adds, I avoid taking a shower at the gym, even after a sweaty sesh, at all costs because gym showers are disgusting. But maybe that's just me. And he calls you out here, JD. He says, because I know JD loves showering at the gym.
I do. I really do.
So what is Dave missing here? Dave finds it disgusting. But you've obviously made peace with it.
I've made 100% peace with it. I love going into the gym, you know, after a hard day's work and I'm already stinky, then I work out, then I'm really stinky. But then you walk out of the gym after a shower and you've used someone else's water, you know, the pressure is usually better, you know. And I don't care. It doesn't bother me. Honestly, around here, most gym showers are better than my shower here. You know what I mean? Like, it's cleaner, I mean, because it gets cleaned every day.
That's true.
So,
yeah, but it doesn't get cleaned necessarily in between every user.
Oh, but so what? People are showering in there.
Well, you feel more comfortable showering after a stranger than, well, say, your son?
No, I guess not. Well, my son.
They're at that age.
They are at that age. But yeah, I think it's fine. It's totally fine. And I've never worn flip-flops into a shower. I've had a thousand showers in a gym. I've never worn flip-flops. I'm just raw footing it in there. It's great.
Raw footing it?
It's great. I really hate leaving the gym completely sweaty, which I do a lot because I've been taking Lincoln to the gym early. So, you know, I'll work out and then he'll shower and I'm still doing my thing. And then I got to take him to school. So I got to get right in the car. And then I'm sitting all gross and sweaty in my cloth seats. I'm not a leather seat guy in my car. So every day my sweaty ass is sitting in that car and I feel gross about it. And then I can't find a car wash that's decent on Yelp to take it to shampoo that seat. So yeah, I'm 1,000% showering at the gym is great. It's awesome.
Not just good, it's great.
It's great.
All right, Trey, what do you think on this one?
Well, I'm like Dave. after a real sweaty sesh, I'm not taking a shower, and I'm throwing a towel on my leather ints and driving home disgusting. But maybe it's just because I'm out of practice. I actually think showering at the gym is probably good. I just haven't done it for such a long time because there's even more prep work needed. Like, you got to bring your shower supplies. Like I said, I do already have a towel, so not a big deal in that regard. But, like, you would want a shampoo. You would want a soap. I know a lot of gyms provide them for sure. But, like, I'm thinking, I play basketball on a Friday morning. It's at a college gym. There's a little tiny locker room. I'm not necessarily going to be trusting their soap dispensers. I'm just not putting in the prep work ahead of time to bring all of my stuff along with me. I'll drive home gross. I'll be sticky and itchy when I get home, but I'm hopping in the shower right away. But JD is giving it such a sterling review that I might throw down a shower this Friday.
What do you think about getting dry, like post-shower? I find it a little hard to get dry in the way I want to be dry at a gym. And that goes from everything from, well, I guess, like, you're just sort of, once you get out of the shower, I assume you have your towel wrapped around you.
Yeah.
Then you get back to your locker.
Yeah.
Now, is the towel off and you're just, you know, like, say you're drying your arms and your undercarriage is just out there?
I do all that stuff in the shower.
In the shower, hidden from you.
Like, as 90% dry when I'm walking back to my locker or whatever.
Okay, but you can't get your feet dry because they're in the shower.
They will dry. They will dry, I promise.
Oh, so you're too scared to take off your towel to wipe your feet. You don't have the guts to dry your toes.
It's air. It's water. It evaporates. By the time I get my socks on, they're usually dry. But I hear what you're saying. There is definitely some moisture back there. And, yeah. You know, I got about 10 years left, and then I'm just that guy, the old man, you know, with his leg up on the up on the sink, and he's blow drying his balls. That's the way, like, I see that every day at the gym.
Every day?
That's certainly another worry.
Like, you got to be comfortable seeing other naked strangers and other strangers seeing you naked.
Yeah. Which, you know, I'm fine with it.
The more you do it, the easier it gets, exactly. I imagine.
Yeah.
I am actually curious about this. Do you dry yourself with a hair dryer at all at home? I'm not talking about your hair. Any other parts of your body?
I have hit the cold, you know, on a hot
underarms.
Day. You know, yeah.
Yeah.
Just to, you know, it's a nice, it feels nice.
I bet it does.
Yeah. TMI, but I do underarms and undercarriage.
Yeah. Why not?
With a hair dryer.
It's your hair dryer, so.
That's true. It's just air.
Yes.
Yeah.
It is my, that's my hair
But the
dryer.
Thing is, at the gym, it's not always. Some gyms provide hair dryers, and that's why I see the old guys, you know, going ham underneath.
Yeah, well, what's the danger there? They're holding the hair dryer with their hand in the same way you would hold it to dry your hair.
Well, yeah, but sometimes I'm blow drying my beard, and I don't like it. It freaks me out, you know.
Fair. Yeah.
Your top beard. But other people had written in as a separate topic, but we might as well talk about this now because I guess it's most relevant in a public setting. Zach S. and John G. wrote in, peeing in the shower, is this good? And they wrote in with a statistic that they said, apparently 61% of Americans pee in the shower. And John G. adds, at home for me, I always pee in the shower as I'm showering. Some of my friends think this is disgusting. They told me that you should turn the shower off, dry myself, step out of the shower, and pee in the toilet.
That's ridiculous.
Which is lunacy.
Yeah.
But as it relates to showering in the gym, are you concerned that since 61% of people are doing it, that they're also doing it at the gym?
They're 100% doing it at the gym, I assume, and I don't care. I don't care.
Doesn't even care enough to put on a flip-flop, and I respect that.
Thank you. Yeah, well, I mean, it saves a flush. What's that, 5 gallons? No, that's...
okay, well,
what's a flush? Not 5 gallons.
Your toilets may vary.
Yeah. We did talk about it on the show, and I did give a figure, but I forget what it is. I
think no it way was it's 5 gallons. Is it?
No, I think it is. Like, I think it was 3 to 5 gallons, depending on how modern your toilet is.
God damn, that is a lot of water for a piss. When you're standing,
so you're pissing in the shower. Is that what you're trying to tell me?
I have pissed in my shower, yes. But I do, and because it's mostly out of fun, is try to aim it right at the drain. You know what I mean? Like, try to get it down there.
Sure. Target practice.
Yeah. And I also, it has to be done before I start soaping up and, you know, shampoo and all that. Because in my mind, it's washing it away.
Yes, 100%.
Coming off my body.
You're cleaning the tub and your body all at the same time.
Exactly.
Right. I agree with that. I pee in 100% of the showers I take
at
home, but I would say like 0% I take on the road.
Oh, I've never done it in the gym.
Totally.
Ever.
Yeah.
Never. Never. Never.
I feel like I would even be nervous to do it at a hotel or at an Airbnb. That's somebody else can piss in that tub.
Yeah.
my tub might piss.
Well, I think at the gym there's also the worry that, like, because has anyone ever walked in on you in the shower?
I mean, oh, it's happened for sure, yeah.
Like, just if it's a curtain?
Yeah.
I guess, I don't know. I mean, you could hear the water running. I don't know why that would happen.
It happened at the Turner gym all the time when we were at
really?
Turner. Yeah, yeah.
Okay, so if you're mid-pee, like, that's probably a bad
exactly.
look.
Exactly. That's why I would never do it.
Though I guess it's kind of hard to tell. That's why you should pee into the water stream so that you can't tell.
Right.
If you pee past it, telltale sign. Trey, what are the people in the stream team saying? In the stream team saying?
They call it the stream team for a reason. 62% of people think it's good.
62%?
62%. Higher than the average person.
What was it? 60% pee in the shower? What was the survey?
61%.
Wow. Wow.
Yeah, we got some piss sickos here. 62%. 38% are just holding it. Just holding it for a long time.
All right. Let's move on to our last topic before we get to settle this. And it is from Bobby W., who asks, bumper stickers, are they good? And I'm going to start by asking, do any of you have bumper stickers on your car?
Trey?
I don't have a bumper sticker, but I do have a Valparaiso University window cling, which is like, you know, like it looks backwards to me, but it goes in the back of your window. So if somebody sees it from behind, it just says Valpo.
Okay.
That was Laura's mom's from back in the day. And I saved it from our old Highlander to go to our new Highlander because I'm honestly trying to get into bumper stickers. Like, I think they look awesome. I think it looks like your car is well-loved and a part of your life rather than just a piece of machinery you have. There's a there's a family that lives down the street from us that has a luggage topper, and it's just got, like, stickers on it from, like, all of the trips they've taken. And I think it looks so cool. It reminds me of George Bailey and It's a Wonderful Life with his steamer trunk. That's like the modern steamer trunk. Yeah. So I'm trying to advocate for getting more bumper stickers in our household. I got to get a Steely to throw it on the Volkswagen now.
Nice.
Yeah.
Is that the Grateful Dead?
Yeah, Grateful Dead. Yeah.
Okay, so that's what your first bumper sticker is going to be a Grateful
That'll
Dead.
That'll be my first one, yeah. And then once I got that one, it just, they will proliferate from there on out.
Right, right.
You're right. It's like getting a tattoo.
Once you get one, you got to get another one. Yeah.
Exactly.
What am I getting
your first
sticker?
One, you're putting a lot of thought into it. Yeah. And then after that, it just becomes like whatever. JD, do you have one? And if not, any guesses or any ideas to what you would want to put on your car?
I have three. They're not bumper stickers. They're magnets, and they're just the kit.
Oh, so you
school.
Can't commit? There's the temporary tattoos?
I can't commit because I feel like I may sell this car at some point. And I don't
Great
want
point.
To True. Have to deal with scraping them off. I say that, but I'm never selling that car. I'll drive it into the ground. Rachel, on the other hand, here, I'll show you Rachel's car. This is the back of her car. And she has a lot of bumper stickers on
oh,
her.
Oh, wow. She got a starter sticker.
She got a starter sticker. She's got ATL. She's got the schools, the Nova Scotia, Canada flag. She's got two Nova Scotia stickers, Halifax sticker. And she has a Feel the Burn and a democracynow.org. Now, those ones cause her problems, I think. She gets a lot of heckling, a lot of people, you know, coming after her, you know. As we're in Georgia, so sometimes people like to yell their political beliefs at you, and they will prejudge you on your driving skills based on your political alignment. So you know, I'm like, I always feel self-conscious when I'm driving her car, you know, because I'm like, I mean, I do. I like Bernie Sanders, yeah, but I don't necessarily like to. You don't know who you're advertising to, you know, behind you, sort of thing. You know, Trey, you said you'd put a Deadhead sticker. I'm like, that guy's stoned. He's driving stoned, 100%. He's probably tripping right now. You know what I mean?
Yeah, that's a good point. Fair enough.
But so I like when I'm driving my car, I like to be as neutral and as anonymous as possible. But you know, respect to Rachel. She doesn't care. She takes the heckles and whatever. It's fine. She's fine with it.
That would make me nervous though, because already every time I hear a honk when I drive, I'm always like, "Is that me? Are they honking at me? Did I do something?"
Right.
I don't know. I always feel like a honk is at me, even when it's just a honk. Could be coming from the opposite direction.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
If I have a bumper sticker that's causing people to honk, well, I suppose if the bumper sticker said like. Honk if yeah, a classic honk if you're horny, for instance, then I would be like, oh, they're honking because of my hilarious right. bumper sticker.
But oh, they're so horny, this guy's super horny.
Yeah, I would never know if they were honking at me because I did something bad in the car or because they were angry at my bumper sticker.
Right.
And further that, is that a stereotype that I don't know? Are libs bad at driving?
No, not necessarily. I don't. Some are probably, but some yeah, are great sure. drivers. But that's not the point. It's like, oh, the person in front of me is a liberal and therefore an idiot. So any infraction, any sort of lapse in judgment, any sort of, you know, 1 second delay waiting for the light to change. Well, you are just a libtard. So honk, you know, or whatever.
Right.
You know? Yeah. Yeah. In Atlanta, people will heckle you anyways. I used to have a Mini Cooper, and I would drive around, and I would, you know, one time a guy in a pickup truck was like, hey, where's the rest of your car? That kind of thing, you know. It's a small car. It's like, it's like, enjoy paying all the gas that you buy, sir, you know.
Other gas mileage.
Yeah, that's, I mean, Jesus.
Yeah, people are crazy.
I think that there's only one cool bumper sticker, and that's the registration sticker.
The registration sticker? Feb 23?
That's the only adornment I want on my car.
Mm. You liked a bumper sticker one time, getting back to speaking of Turner. I remember you even like you tweeted about it. It was it said, nice Prius, and then a quote underneath, nobody. And it was on a Prius, which was great.
Yeah, funny.
It was great.
I do remember that. Yeah, that's that's funny. I mean, I think the one that I see that annoys me the most is the closer you get, the slower I go.
Okay. Yeah,
written in font that's big enough. Look, if you're driving, you should be able to see like 8 feet in front of you. So I don't really find that to be a very relevant bumper sticker. Mm.
Yeah.
It just makes me want to get closer to you, which I right. wouldn't do because I don't tailgate. But Jesus loves you. Everyone else thinks you're an asshole. Another common one.
Yeah. See, I don't want my bumper sticker to be having a conversation with anybody.
Right.
I just
right.
want my bumper sticker to be a logo of something that I think is good or a place that I've been rather than like insulting or encouraging conversation betwixt drivers.
Right.
Yeah.
Right.
More of a signifier of something than a, hey, let's talk about the rules of the road out here.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah, for sure. One thing I've seen that I don't know if this is true, but there were some statistics out there that said if you have bumper stickers on your car, people are less likely to steal it.
Yeah, because you can't sell it. And it's easy to find it. It's easy to, hey, there's a, yeah, I have a deadhead sticker on the back of the car.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly. Mine's the one with the 26.2 sticker on the car. Oh, everyone else has that one. I did see, though, speaking of being in Atlanta, that the Georgia Supreme Court in 1991 said bumper stickers are protected by the First Amendment.
Oh.
So I guess you could really have anything on there. So I encourage you to. I don't know if it's protected here in California, but for you guys, go ham with those bumper stickers.
Yeah.
Just be aggressive as possible. And what are the people saying, Trey?
62% of people are saying bumper stickers are not good.
Wow.
I mean, I'm... Well, what was your final ruling, JD? Trey said they're good.
I'm good.
You know what? I'm going to say they're good. I agree. I like what Trey said about the personalizing your car like you would an old suitcase sort of thing. Like these are the places these are the states I've been in, and you know, this is what I what I believe. This is what, you know, all that stuff. If you want, put a Jesus fist on your car if you want. Like, go for it. Like, tell me who you are, and then I will judge you for it.
All right. Well, I guess we're deadlocked in a tie. We're not going to come to an agreement on that one. We have to take one more break. But when we come back, JD and Trey, this is very serious. They're going to tell someone whether they should have another child.
Oh, shit.
If I were to check my search history, right at the top would be, when does the pharmacy close? Well, Amazon has a pharmacy. Yes, that Amazon. And it doesn't close. Amazon Pharmacy delivers a better pharmacy experience that delivers directly to your door and works with most insurance plans. And it helps you save time, save money, and stay healthy. Prime members can save up to 80% on their prescriptions. America. And there's transparent pricing, so you know what you'll pay before you pay it. And there are real pharmacists who are always available at Amazon Pharmacy, no matter what time it is. Jeff Bezos just got his pharmacy certification. Nah, Bezos ain't there. Anyways, your medication gets delivered to your door. A pharmacy that works for your life with meds delivered doesn't get better than that. Switch to Amazon Pharmacy and save time, save money, and stay healthy. Learn more at amazon.com/nodunks. That's amazon.com/nodunks. amazon.com/nodunks. Average savings based on usage and inside RX data as compared to cash prices. Average savings for all generics are 78%, 37% for select brand medications. Restrictions apply.
Welcome back to Is This Good, guys? When people need help navigating life's biggest decisions, when they're lost, confused, at a crossroads, they seek our wise counsel, and we deliver an airtight verdict. It's time to settle this. All right, we have a very serious question here, and it goes as follows. Hello, ITG crew. My wife and I have an amazing 3-year-old son, and I truly feel like we hit the jackpot. But I come from a family with 5 older siblings, and my wife has a younger brother, so we both like the idea of our son having a sibling. However, being a stay-at-home mom has been tough for my wife at times, and we're both apprehensive about restarting the whole process that comes with a newborn, considering we're only a couple years away from gaining a lot more flexibility. Knowing that JD and Trey have 2 kids, I'd love to hear them weigh in. We're financially stable and have a good home, but the biggest concerns are the strain it could put on our relationship and shifting the timeline for when my wife returns to work. Thanks, Marco. So Marco is reaching out to you guys because you both have 2 kids and asking you a very serious question. You could be responsible for a child. Should Marco and his wife have a second kid?
Ooh.
This is too much responsibility.
It's a lot of responsibility.
I got my own 2 kids to worry about. I don't need a third out there. Marco's kid.
Yeah.
It's a tough one.
You know, I'm going to say no. Don't have the second kid. You said it yourself, Marco. You hit the jackpot. When you hit the jackpot, you walk away from the table. And I also think, I mean, this is based on only my experience. I think you missed your window. That your first kid is already three, probably out of diapers, you know, got that little bit of independence. And yeah, it's, I think it's too, it's nice to have siblings, but they're too far apart, I think. That's what I think.
So I don't have any kids, but would you agree? Because this is what I seem to hear from a lot of people and what I've observed, that the first child is great, like a great kid, and makes you, lulls you into this sense of security. They're like, hey, we can do this. Mm-hmm. And then the second kid is always more chaotic and, you know, kind of throws your life upside down. Do you see that dynamic in your experience?
Certainly in mine. I mean, Lincoln was a pretty, you know, he was a normal baby, but which is stressful enough. And then Jackson came along 18 months later and he had colic and he was a fucking nightmare for an entire year. And plus we had a kid who was also still a toddler, like not even two yet. So, yeah, it was I wouldn't change anything. And obviously he's an awesome, you know. I can't imagine my life without him. So there is that, Marco. Like,
yeah, that's right, Jackson. If you're listening to, your father does not regret having you.
Of
okay?
course
that's,
not.
It's
of
on
course
the
not. But it was a very, very rough year. I mean, and you know, two kids is two kids. It's more than one kid. You know, Trey will attest
twice
to this. It's the double the amount of kids.
Double
so,
the kids.
You know, and Marco's wife is worried about going back to work or whatever, like getting on with her life, and that will put it back another a year at least for, you know, the mat leave or wherever she happens to be. But you know, it's very hard having two kids, but it's also great. So you know, but I would say that just the way he was talking about how he hit the jackpot. That sticks in my mind. Mm-hmm. You know, it's time.
Yeah, but everybody thinks that after the first kid, you're like, first kid, this went so well. No way it can go as well again the second time around. And like you're saying, I'm sure Jackson was a little more challenging, mm-hmm. but you still feel like you hit the jackpot the second time.
100%.
So I'm saying, do it, Marco. Have the second kid. The gap is not too big. It's actually going to be perfect. No doubt you're going to be starting all over again. I remember when Ada was born. The first thought that went through my head as I held my second-born daughter, you can't even hold your head up. I literally have to start all over this again. And I mean, it was like a 20-month separation for us between Isla and Ada.
Yeah.
So we were still in diaper phase with Isla, and we were doing double diapers for a time, and that's super tough. Marco, if you and your wife were to get pregnant now, your oldest child will be 4 years old when the younger one is born.
True.
Like, that's getting on the verge of being able to do a lot of stuff around the house as a four-year-old.
That four-year-old's not changing diapers, though.
That four-year-old's not changing diapers, but you're also not having to change that four-year-old's diapers. Things are going to get easier and easier. And as the older kid gets older, they're going to want to help so much more. Like, that to me, our kids are so close in age that I feel like Isla almost missed out a little bit on getting to be like a nurturer to Ada, just because she didn't really understand it being less than 2 years old.
Mm-hmm.
Not, but if we would have had Ada when she was four, like Isla would have been so caring for her and so helpful. So I think you're definitely going to go through some tough times, and obviously everybody's family situation is different, but in the long run, you're going to love your sibling having like a built-in best friend. You're going to love the closeness they develop. It'll be totally worth it.
Yeah,
built-in best friend or sibling rivalry, and they're at each other's throats.
Right.
Like, for instance, me and my sister were like a classic back of the car.
No doubt, no doubt.
She's breathing on me. She's too close to my side of the car kind of thing. I mean, I, again, don't have kids. I think I eventually will. And the only thing that makes me think having two kids is good is that somewhere in my mind, I've been conditioned to believe that only children are bad. Like, they're assholes or they're selfish. I mean, do you find that to be true? Do you find that to be a good reason to have a second kid? saying like, we're going to, by having a second kid, we're going to save this first kid from becoming a narcissistic asshole.
Oh, I see what you're saying. Like an only child can be
yes,
narcissistic or whatever. I mean, is that a reason to have another child? I mean, I don't know. Maybe. The dynamic of your family is going to change, like 100%. And my kids are polar opposites. You know, one is a jock and one is an artist type. So they have a completely different set of friends. They go to a completely different high school. They're different, but it's awesome. The new dynamic in our family is great. But yeah, I mean, I don't know.
But JD, people, Shaquille O'Neal was also a rapper, so you could have athlete and artist.
That's true.
In the same pack.
That's true. Hey, well, you know, Jackson plays the drums and he plays the bass. So yeah, they're two very well-rounded individuals, but they're very different. So Marco, your second child may be very different, and that's not a bad thing at all. But it can be a strain on a relationship, especially if the mom wants to go back to work.
Oh, yeah.
And all of that stuff. And you're risking your marriage for another child just because you come from a big family and you think that you should have a child. I don't think you should feel that pressure, I guess is what I'm saying.
They're going to have a good second child. You can already tell.
I think so, too.
Yeah.
I think so, too. But, you know. Even if you have the best child in the world, it's still stressful.
No doubt.
Parents, like, I saw a newborn baby the other day in a stroller, and I was like, those poor bastards.
Oh yeah.
You know,
yeah,
you're
yeah,
just
yeah.
like, oh God. And they're just out having during Porch Fest, and they were just out, and they're like, what are you guys doing here? You know, like, this is, you know, it's fun, I guess, but then you're going to have to go back and nap and feed, and you're going to probably be up all night with this kid. And, you know, it's just, I just feel bad for people who have newborns for the first 6 months.
Good. Well, Marco, don't have that kid. And thanks, JD. You've convinced me not to have it. I say Marco, don't have the kid, because that's the advice I feel most comfortable telling you.
Yeah.
Because if you really want one, you're gonna have one anyways.
When in doubt, so fair enough.
Hey, one reason to have another kid is you're gonna get to have sex at least once.
Hey, Marco.
52% of people say Marco should not have a second kid.
Oh, wow.
honey, yeah, I asked the guys on the podcast. They asked everyone they know if we should have a second kid. They were for it, but everybody else disagreed.
Yeah, I mean, you'd have to be telling your wife that, like, it was really right on the border. Like, 48% of people do not want us to have another kid.
All right, we're up to 49% yeses.
Wow.
If we stay on long enough, we might get to over 50%, and then they got to.
All right, let's keep an eye on that, Marco. We haven't come up with a decision just yet. It's time to get to the final segment of the show. It's subjective trivia. Yes, subjective trivia. It's just like regular trivia, except only I know the answer. Guys, you may have read that the original Blink-182 lineup of Tom DeLonge, Travis Barker, and Mark Hoppus are reuniting for the first time since 2015 for an international tour. First question, did you know that they are reuniting?
Yes.
We were talking about that this morning, actually.
Yes, actually.
Okay, now, would it be safe to say that neither of you are big Blink-182 heads?
Safe for me, that's for sure, yeah.
Yeah, I would agree that I'm not a big Blink-182 fan, but, you know, like, knowing that they are reuniting, I was like, I know a lot more Blink-182 songs than I thought I did.
Okay, great. I'm glad to hear you say that, because, as always, I have the correct answer written on this card, so you know I'm not cheating. Today's question is, what is the best Blink-182 song? Ooh. I want to give a caveat here. I'm also not a big Blink-182 head. Obviously, I'm a sentient being, so I know a lot of these songs. They're often quite catchy, and they were played a ton on the radio back when the radio was a thing in the late 90s and early 2000s. But since neither of you are big 182 heads, I've created just a list of what I consider to be their five most popular songs. Now, you're not going to see First Date or Rock Show on here, even though those were big songs. But I've written here Adam's Song, Damn It, All the Small Things, I Miss You, What's My Age Again? Those are your five choices. Yeah. Again, I don't know the deep cuts, so you could tell me that there's, you know, track 12 on Take Off Your Pants and Jacket is a real hidden gem. I don't know. I've never heard it. I only really truly realized that Take Off Your Pants and Jacket was a pun.
Mm. Oh, you just realized that.
Yeah, I didn't just realize that today, but honestly, in the last couple years, wow. I was like, oh, Take Off Your Pants and Jacket. Jacket. So here all we go. Right. What is the best Blink-182 song?
So we're looking for your favorite Blink-182 song.
As always, technically that's correct, but it's just what is the best? See what you think. See if that's the correct answer. Right.
Right. Are music videos a factor in this decision?
No, not for... Though, you know what's funny? Because obviously there's that famous video where they're naked running through the streets. Uh-huh. And I always assumed that was the video for All the Small Things, because that would be a funny joke.
Yeah.
Small Things, they're naked. But it's the video for What's My Age Again.
Huh.
There you go.
So again, okay. Adam's song,
pure
damn
music,
it.
We're talking.
Purely music.
You want to see them again, Trey?
Yeah, let's see these again. Okay.
I am only really familiar with All the Small Things and What's My Name Again. Trey was playing a couple of these because we thought this was coming up because he sent this earlier, Matt.
Mm-hmm.
And I recognized a few of them, but I was also distracted, so. Yeah.
Okay, so here's the question for me, JD. There's five songs here. I'm ruling out Damn It.
Okay.
I don't think that's going to finish number one for Matt here. Adam's song and I Miss You to me are more mature sounding music, more mature records from Blink 182, like more dynamic, you know, more moody. Mm-hmm. You got Travis Barker doing different drum patterns than just smashing on the cymbals. However, All the Small Things, What's My Age Again, that is like the definition of a Blink 182 pop punk song, right? Like hard guitars, you got the kind of whiny voice coming from these guys, or maybe the deeper voice from Hoppus there, and of course Travis Barker just shredding it on the drums.
Right.
My guess is that Matt probably likes Adam's song and I Miss You more as songs, but he recognizes we're talking pop punk here. Mm-hmm. So you gotta pick a very Blink 182 song. And I think he's going to go with What's My Age Again as the number one hit.
You know, that's what I'm thinking as well. But I need to get a little taste of Adam's song, so I'm just going to...
Oh, wow. I didn't know we were allowed to do this.
Well, we're not, but I need to hear it. Okay, this thing. Yeah.
This is their sort of suicide song.
Right.
I never thought I'd die alone.
Right.
You know, I guess it's about as close as they get to a ballad.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, it's catchy. Their songs are catchy. I've always considered them a low-rent Green Day, if you will.
Sure.
I would agree.
But yeah, my instinct is What's My Name Again? Because it's catchy as hell.
You keep calling it What's My Name Again.
What's Age Again? It's blocked by the preview on my thing here. Yeah, that's what I'm going to say. But
okay, so your final answer is?
What's My Age Again?
What's My Age Again?
Okay, What's My Age Again? Well, damn it. You didn't get it right. Because the answer is...
What?
Damn it.
That's a shocker to me.
Wow.
Yeah, well, I don't know, JD. Do you want to give us a taste of that then?
Yeah. Let me find it. Hold on.
That's the one that goes, definitely has the lyric. I guess that this is growing older up.
Up, yeah.
Up and old.
Okay, so first of all, this riff is their best riff.
Yeah, this is a good riff.
Yeah.
And it's got some really good, like, herky-jerky vocals.
Okay. This is this maybe their earliest song of these five? I don't know.
So there were two albums before Dude Ranch, but this is their first big song.
Okay.
And first big song I heard, and I think it's the most fun, propulsive song they have.
Yeah.
You know, there's also that timing, structure, did you hear, he fucked her, you know, it's very angsty, very teen. And then the lament, I guess this is growing up. So Adam's song is a number two. I do like them when they're in sort of slightly ballad mode, but damn it, is Blink-182's best song. I actually did look it up just to see what actual fans of the band thought, and it does seem like that's their, not to bring up this can of worms again, but their final encore song. So I guess probably many people agree that Damn It is the best Blink-182 song, but now you know for sure. If you have topics, tweet them into me at StartersMatt or email us at isthisgoodpod@gmail.com. Do you guys have anything to promote?
Do we have anything to promote? Oh, we got podcasts galore, Matty. Oh, what do we got tomorrow, JD? We got part 4 of our Burning Questions season preview.
That is correct.
That will be on this here No Dunks Inc. channel. We've also got our recap of episode 4 of Survivor season 43 tonight. That will be on the No Buffs channel, 1 p.m. Eastern, I do believe we said.
Yep, that's right.
You watching Survivor yet, Matt?
Not yet. I've heard it's a good time to get in.
Great time to get in. Perfect time. Perfect time.
All right. Thanks for listening. For everyone, I'm Matt Austin, and this was good. We'll see you next week.